Morning, I'm John Penile. Welcome to this special edition of Penile's Politics. Well, now you've thought about it, would you go to jail for your freedom? Really, who can tell? And lucky for us, we don't have to face that choice. But we do like to salute those who sacrifice more than we'll ever have to and perhaps ever could. Seven men stood in the dock alongside Nelson Mandela 52 years ago at what came to be called the Rivonia Trial, accused of terrorism after standing against apartheid in South Africa. Three survive, and one, Dennis Goldberg, called the baby of the Rivonia trial then, and now 82, joins me live and exclusively in a moment. Mandela's eldest child, Makaziwe Maki, to her friends, is here too. The leader of the Liberal Democrats, what's left of them, Tim Farron, is on the show, plus Labour's Chuka Amuna, who thinks his party's overlooking potential supporters, taking ethnic minority votes for granted and could end up paying for it. And as ever, two of the brightest and best of our political pundits. I do like to big up our pundits. It's a real crowd scene in the studio this morning. So let's just introduce them. Ian Birrell, the contributing editor at The Mail on Sunday. Hi, Ian. Thanks for coming in. Written extensively on Africa, on South Africa, and many, many other things. Kevin Maguire here too, again, at The Mirror Economist. Hello, Kevin. What are you doing? It's good to get both of you in here this morning to talk to our guests. Apart from anything else, Kevin and Ian, you've got the memory and the mileage to recall the days of the apartheid era and the way it looked from here. So just looking back very, very briefly, Ian, just pick out a memory from that time and tell us about it.
Well, for me, it was one of the defining issues as I grew up, and like a lot of people, it was something that politicised me. And I can remember taking, you know, I've never dreamt of banking at Barclays because of the boycott. And actually, I joined the Conservatives as a student and became president of the Aberdeen Association. I remember going to a Federation of Conservative Student Conference, and one of the first things I saw was people there with badges saying, "Hang Nelson Mandela." And I was so horrified that actually I withdrew the party, the branch from the National Party, and got called down to central office and everything. And the lack of action actually made me leave at that time because I was so depressed. So it was absolutely a shake for me, and that's one of the reasons now that I still do a lot in Africa and I run an African music project. And it's been a very influential backdrop to my life. So I'm honoured to have Dennis here with us because he's one of the unsung heroes, I think, of the human rights struggle around the world.
It'll be great to hear from Dennis in just a second. And Kevin, you were on a few anti-apartheid demos in your time, I think.
I did. I wasn't a great marcher, but defeating apartheid in South Africa was one of the great moral causes in the 1970s and 1980s. And it even got somebody like me to go along to demonstrations and meetings and go outside South Africa House. And I, too, when I was a student, and opening a bank account for the first time in your life, wouldn't go anywhere near Barclays because it became a symbol of all those companies, all those British companies that were doing trade with South Africa.
Let's just now formally say a good morning and a welcome to Sir Matthew Mandela. Also, Nelson Mandela, morning to you. Matthew, also to you, morning. Dennis Goldberg. You stood trial
morning. On
Nelson Mandela, and you spent 22 years in a South African jail for standing against apartheid. In your case, it was a whites-only prison. You were the only white man, as I've said, among the activists who were arrested after that raid in the Joburg
Correct, and the only one sentenced.
Only one sentenced, yes. And the others were in a part of the process. After that raid, of course, the ANC, of which you were then involved as well, but members, they're now the majority party, the government of South Africa. You now, Dennis, and another of those of the Rivonia trial survivors, Ahmed Kathrada. You're meeting David Cameron in Downing Street tomorrow. Later in the week, you're going to be getting the honour of the Freedom of the City of London. I know you're going to go to Brixton in South London later on in the week, which I think may be as much fun as anything else that you do this week. You're being treated like a rock star of the liberation movements of the world. I've referred to you earlier this week, looking ahead to the show, as a living icon, and I would apologise to you for that sort of embarrassing description, but I suspect you're getting used to that kind of thing. You are polishing your fingernails. It must be strange.
It is strange because to be treated as a terrorist, to be hated as a betrayer of white South Africa, and to be treated as a traitor throughout the trial and the imprisonment, and to come out and to find my comrades on the verge of achieving power, to have seen the developments, the remarkable developments, and some of the sadnesses, but to travel the world and be asked to talk about it, as I've been asked today, is a great honour. And I feel it's an interesting story in a world where intolerance of religion and racism is rife, not only in my own country, but in many places. I feel if I have a calling, I'm compelled to tell this story.
It is an extraordinary story. We're all looking forward, I think, to hearing some of your thoughts on that story, but of course about chat over the next half hour or so. And Mackie Mandela, this extraordinary treatment that you're getting as you travel around this country that you're getting at home in South Africa. Difficult to imagine, especially bearing the name that you do.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but one of the things that I walk with, I think, daily is what my dad taught me, and I think people like Uncle Dennis, Uncle Kathy, is to walk with humility and dignity. And that they didn't live for themselves, they lived for a higher cause. And when my dad stood on the dock at Duvonia, he was not standing there for himself, he was standing for the glorious we, that they were prepared to die for the cause for which they were standing for, was to see the freedom of all peoples, of all colors, of all creeds in South Africa. And today, my generation, my daughter's generation, is enjoying a full South Africa, but it took a lot of sacrifice.
Indeed. In a moment, I want to introduce both of you to our youngest in the studio. There's Kat Brooker there, Dennis and Mackie, and Adam Schwartz. Now, they are just getting interested and involved in politics through a charity I know a good deal about called Patchwork, which is there to engage underrepresented communities in politics. I'm going to invite them in a short while to put some questions to both of you, if I may. Before I do, just something I'd like to get your thoughts on now, if I can, briefly. Given your past experience, and I want to hear more about that, given your sacrifice, 22 years in jail, when you look at your country, South Africa, today, with a declining economy, rising unemployment, a leader, an ANC president, dogged by accusations of corruption, and the party, the ANC, losing members, losing support, how do you feel? Do you feel disappointed, even maybe let down in any way?
First, I want to say there's another survivor you didn't mention, Andrew Mlangeni,
who's not
well, say, couldn't come with us today. A great, great person, I have to say. What do I feel about South Africa? In all honesty, I think we've come a tremendous way in only 20 years. Our background in education, in healthcare, in a lack of a trained civil service. In 1994, we had a civil service, served the needs of 5 million whites and controlled the rest of the population. Suddenly needed policies and implementation for 42 million people. Where do you get them from? We're still struggling to create a proper trained civil service with integrity.
Yeah.
And it's not just political leaders. People throughout the country who never had a chance before are saying, now it's our turn. First, the English came and exploited us and corrupted our country and stole the land and our people. Then the Afrikaners took over together with the English, and now it's a new group who have been co-opted. It's a way of a world of exploitation and corruption. We're not free of international attitudes. So, yes, I'm sad. I'm sad at the extent of it. It's one reason I didn't choose to go into government. I stayed out of it. Because I knew it would happen. I set up a charity because I could move more nimbly and I could pretend I'm clean.
Did you know it was going to happen, Dennis? Could you have foreseen some of the scandals that have beset the government, the economic problems of the government?
We came out of a scandalous, corrupt society. Apartheid, there was flush money, busting sanctions, ships being sunk, oil being sold twice over, government officials involved, fraudulent budgets and money being spent, exposed to judicial commissions of inquiry. We choose to forget that.
Yeah.
Suddenly now you see it's a black government, we can say, you see how corrupt they are. This is a way of the world as well. The good things that happen every day in South Africa are not reported. And I say we've come a tremendous long way, but we could have come further. And those who are corrupt, you see, I would call it a cronyism in the society around political leaders at every level of government, down to the smallest village elected council. Show me a world where it doesn't happen in our modern world.
Mm.
Only people have become accustomed to doing it, they don't get caught so easy.
Okay,
but I noticed, just to finish,
yeah.
the British Parliament is introducing new laws, new regulations for ethical control of members of Parliament. You don't introduce new rules unless there's a problem. We face the same problems.
On that, Dennis. Now, I've got to break off this for 1 second. I know you're going to be interested in this because you follow your cricket. And I want to get us an update now for the test underway right now. Henry Moran is in Pretoria. Henry?
Yeah, just 90 miles north of that very Johannesburg suburb that you've been discussing. And here at Centurion, England are struggling in the morning session. Joe Root, the latest man out, he's gone for 76, edging behind to give Kagiso Rabada a third wicket of the innings. Both England's overnight batsmen, Alistair Cook and now Joe Root, have fallen for 76 in a morning session that is rapidly becoming South Africa's. England 209 for 4 now, the deficit 266.
Thanks, Henry. Hopefully you later on. Hopefully with a bit better news than all of that. I'm going to bring in now our two young guests through Patchwork, Kat Brooker and Adam Schwartz. You guys want to put a question to Dennis and to Matthew. Let's just start with this, Adam, because you have a connection with the Rivonia trial, albeit an indirect one, which Dennis, I know, doesn't know much about. Just tell us about it.
Yes, that's right. My grandfather, Harry Schwartz, was on the defence team of the Rivonia trial. As a lawyer, he defended Jimmy Cantor, who was number 8 accused. Jimmy was actually acquitted, along with Rusty Bernstein, with the only two people who were actually acquitted during the trial. And I've always admired my grandfather's courage to defend him during the trial. Because I think Philip Mandela himself wrote in Long Walk to Freedom that actually the reason why Jimmy Cantor was actually arrested and sort of intimidated in this way was actually deliberately to intimidate progressive lawyers. Mm. So as a progressive lawyer, you know, I've always admired my grandfather for that.
Well, take a chance. Put your question to them.
Great. Well, I was wondering, you know, if you have any memories of Jimmy Cantor during the trial?
I'd never met Jimmy Cantor. He was a bit of a playboy. Criminal lawyer. No, he really was. Motorboat, fancy clothes, and meeting in what was high society in Johannesburg. And he was arrested because his brother-in-law, who was part of his law firm, escaped. And so they arrested Jimmy as a revenge. Jimmy sat down on the neighboring toilet with me in our exercise yard and, whispering off the foul of his mouth in good criminal fashion, said, "Hello, I'm Jimmy Cantor. Don't tell me anything you don't want the police to know, because they promised me my release if I bring information." And I want to tell you, it's the greatest courage I know, to say I can be released, but don't tempt me. Jimmy, in the end, had a breakdown. He was treated by a psychiatrist. In the end, it cost him his marriage and the love of his children. I admire that kind of courage, because he wasn't actually involved.
Mm.
I don't think he was as totally innocent as we claimed, but he wasn't worthy of being tried in the trial we were involved in. So my memory of Jimmy is of a really little guy. He was short, cocky as hell, and courageous,
yeah.
And would not accept the oppression of the security police. Yeah. It wouldn't break.
I want to ask Kat to put a question in just a second, but since you mentioned your times behind bars, Dennis, just give us a sense of what it was like as a white accused in that trial, sent to life, and then sent to a whites-only jail, as you would have been under apartheid at that time, surrounded by white prison guards, white fellow prisoners. How did that feel?
Well, there were always some prisoners there with me, political prisoners, and it's the solidarity of your fellow prisoners that helps you get through. And the conditions changed from one letter every 6 months for the first couple of years and 3 months, and then more and more. At the very time you need the most contact, you're cut off. It becomes very lonely. Prison guards who are determined to break you if they can, and you fight back every single day of your life, holding them to their own regulations and compelling them to respect you. It took 15 years until they would say good morning and they'd greet you properly. And across stomach ulcers, and for young men, prostate problems, and it's typical of long-term imprisonment for men. All I can say is prison's not a very nice place.
No.
I don't recommend it.
No.
But if you come through it, and we were able to study by long-distance study through the University of South Africa, that was an absolute lifesaver, because they cut us off from all news. If a visitor tried to tell us what was happening, they would cut the visit short. My dad was threatened with never being able to visit me again. He was in his 80s.
You did actually study several degrees during your time behind bars. You were doing a law degree by the time you were finally released.
Well, I was halfway through a law degree, and I got released, and there were enough lawyers making trouble in the world.
Yeah,
so I'd never finished it.
You also made an attempt, and not a bad one, I think it's right to say, to bust out.
Well, I tried to escape during the 90 days. I got out of the prison, and some ordinary criminal prisoners raised the alarm. I was recaptured quite quickly and spent a month in leg irons and handcuffs and what have you. But in the end, we got three prisoners away from an ultra-maximum security prison. I was part of it and very proud of it. Nice slap in the face for the government.
You were spotted shimmying past the window.
That's how I got caught, yes, when I escaped. And got a couple of broken ribs out of it. And so it's in the past now.
Cat Brooker, please take a question.
Yeah, absolutely. So you talked a lot about prejudice still being around and, you know, tackling discrimination being really important. And we've recently seen a lot of non-Muslims stand up for Muslims facing Islamophobia, for example, and a lot of men standing up for women in the UN. I was wondering, as a white man fighting to end the apartheid system, how important do you think it is that oppressors, or, you know, people from the oppressive group on top stand up for those below them?
I think it's fundamental that one has a sense of values, that people are people, and I was brought up that way. I have to say my parents were communists, came out of the East End of London, a sailor, my father, a seamstress, my mother. In South Africa, they were privileged. But in our home, there were people of all races, workers and professors and doctors and lawyers, and I was required to respect people and grew to respect people for their integrity, for their courage, for their clarity, for their stance against Nazi Germany in World War II. That's when I grew up, in the 30s. Why racism in South Africa when we fight racism in Nazi Europe? There's just a contradiction there. And so, I mean, I was reading newspaper headlines as a six-year-old. And so I learned that as a white, to say, why do we oppress other people? Why do we say they're different when I can see they're the same? And I think it's absolutely essential, and I think you will find in every liberation movement, whether it was Lenin out of a middle-class family or Mao Zedong out of a land-owning family, become class enemies, as they say, and to become, yes, I was a traitor to apartheid white South Africa, but I'm very proud of it, because it's necessary that the oppressed should know, and they're forgetting in South Africa today, the emergence of white racism and also black racism in a very complex society is very frightening in South Africa today. So it's necessary to stand up and say people are people and have to be treated equally as our constitution guarantees. That's a miracle. We have such a constitution. Ahmed Kathrada's foundation is committed to fighting for non-racism. That's how important it is.
Yeah.
So,
I think that's an important message, Dennis. But this sort of conflict between, I don't know, self-interest and compassion, the sense for justice, it is an eternal conflict. It's an eternal dilemma. For example, in South Africa in recent times, we've seen a good deal of tension and some violence towards migrants, economic migrants, coming into South Africa from outside, from poorer countries looking for work, and it's caused an awful lot of friction and some violence too. When you look at this continent of Europe, there is an enormous wave of migration taking place, much of it away from the conflict zone of Syria into the country, causing enormous stress. People fearing, it should be said, for their jobs, for their livelihoods, for, as they perceive it, the services that they depend on in their communities. Can you understand those fears as well?
8 to 10% of the South African population are non-documented immigrants from all over Africa. And every now and then a xenophobic outburst occurs. But more and more, for instance, a Mozambican taxi driver was in the end murdered by South African policemen. Ordinary South Africans stood by, filmed it on their cell phones, their mobile phones,
and took a stand in favour of the Mozambican. This is such a turning point. But ask Maki, she's in business in South Africa, ask her how it goes.
Maki.
Despite the name Mandela.
Look, I mean, there's no doubt that we are in South Africa facing huge challenges. But there's no way that you turn around 350 years of an oppressive, violent government over 20 years or 21 years. It's an impossibility. Europe had freedoms long before us. They're faced with racism, with xenophobia now. You know, we talk about the migrant problem of Europe. We don't talk about what has caused it. Journalists like you don't talk about the causes of this migration. As long as those who are in power, John, continue to go to the lands and pillage and destroy, you will see this iniquity. You will see former colonial oppressed people flooding in what they think are the areas of freedom, of gold, of milk and honey. It's the same
issue. But it isn't so much a test perhaps for people in those areas who, as they perceive it, see people coming in from outside, taking what they believe to be theirs, whether it's job opportunities or access to services. I'm not necessarily making a case for that point of view, but you can easily understand why it's there.
Yes, because people are not understanding. Why is it, you know, what has happened in South Africa, you explained, it's a myth, it's an illusion that Mozambicans, Zambians, whether it's Senegalese, whether it's people from, are taking South African jobs. Most of these people are very entrepreneurial because their governments don't provide the framework. They come into South Africa, they are street traders, and they're flourishing. And instead of us, as South Africa, embracing them and saying, teach us how you can come into a foreign country and flourish, we see them as enemies. And actually it comes from apartheid. I'm not trying to excuse that, where the apartheid regime created this divide and conquer. You see, you blacks in South Africa are better than the blacks north of the Limpopo or the Orange River. And so we have come to believe as South African blacks that we are part of Africa, but we are not, because it goes to the language. We talk about Africa and us. And it starts, freedom is in the mind. It's not just removing the physical shackles.
But you'd have to concede, Matthew and, yes, and Dennis, would you not, that yeah, the governing party of South Africa, the African National Congress government, its president, have a great deal to do, still more to do, to justify the trust that they started with, thanks to the sacrifice of your father, your friend.
Yes, it is true. But let me tell you, the ANC government, we are living in South Africa in a far, far better society than we were in 350 years. Despite the fact that we have huge challenges, the ANC government has been able to maintain the infrastructure, has been able to make, you remember that the ANC government inherited a lot of the apartheid debt. We don't talk about that. That was not committed by us blacks. It was debt that was enjoyed by 13% of the white population in South Africa.
I've also seen, Dennis, yes, you also have been dealing with young people in South Africa, not unlike our guests here, who have become disillusioned, who need to be persuaded that the process is worth pursuing in the way that you would so strongly argue.
I'm sorry, when it comes to the economy, it's three times bigger now than it was in 1994. That's the ANC government's doing, and the people of South Africa. Young people are disillusioned. My despair is that we don't teach our own history to know, that they should know how far we've come. We talk about the failure of education. When I went to university a few days ago in 1950, There was a sea of white faces. Go onto any campus today, there is South Africa represented, and the majority of students are black. How do they get there if the education system has totally failed? So there is a sense of, my despair is that the editors of the mainstream media are part of the student uprising of 1976, and today they behave like the editors anywhere. Scandal sells media. And they don't offer positive solutions.
I wish you could go on for another 4 hours, actually. We're unable to go on for another 4 hours. But just picking up the point you're making there of how attitudes have changed, there's more concern in key places like the media about such issues as racial equality. But then you see arguments flowing up. And here's one, which arguably, from one point of view, isn't the most important thing in the world, but the headlines would suggest otherwise. In Hollywood, there's an argument about the movie industry, not enough or any black actors being represented in the nomination. Now, is that a serious matter for you? Just give me your take on that, please. Before we let you go, Dan.
Just to wrap up that point, we have undoubtedly made huge progress. We have more progress to make. Corruption is a problem. I personally believe, and I would say publicly as I do in South Africa, the members of the ANC need to renew the leadership from top to bottom. Not going to name names, because it's a problem throughout, from national, provincial, and local government level.
A full clear out.
It needs a definite attempt by members to say, enough is enough. Let us focus on the needs of our people, not on your needs as new political leaders with access to power, and therefore wealth and personal enrichment, which robs us, in a way, of our freedom. And this is what the young people are really protesting about, but in their ignorance of not knowing where they've come from in over 20 years to get to university.
People milking the system. And the point I raised there, from one point of view, trivial or maybe
openly,
not.
Openly, and this is a measure of the democratic constitution and its implementation.
Yeah.
It's a matter of daily debate and discussion and protest in the streets.
These are very, very big questions. I suggest there should be a clear up from top to bottom. This is really quite a big statement to make. So against that context and background, the scale of these thoughts, is an argument about the number of black actors not represented in the Oscar nominations. Is that significant at all to you?
I think it's very significant. You have to understand that the struggle of oppressed people anywhere in the world is a struggle of oppressed people around the world. You can't say I'm only concerned about my own backyard. Remember that when the struggle happened in South Africa, it was embraced without them being supported by people who cared around the world. But we would still, apartheid would still be in place today. The fact that there was empathy and sympathy from London, from the two gentlemen that are sitting, many, many more, in Australia, in New Zealand, in America, and that they could identify with what was happening in South Africa, forced the South African government to change. And so we can't say from South Africa, we are removed from the struggle and oppression of people anywhere in the world.
Okay, Mackie and Dennis, I would say not to go on with this. I have to let you go. Tomorrow, Dennis, you will be
want to say, look how our children have learnt the lessons and are so articulate about the complexity and our international relations. I'm so proud to know you.
Thank you.
Dennis, much appreciated. And Dennis, before you go, tomorrow you're meeting Dennis Cameron, representing Downing Street. You'll be as part of your tour of being honoured around this place. Anything that you'll be saying to him, any message for him in particular you're taking into number 10?
Let us not do it through the media.
Yeah, you could always ask him about that free trip he had to apartheid in South Africa.
You know, that Dennis is the kind of answer I'm very used to on this show. It's been fantastically good to have you.
But you're going to be there.
I'm going to be there at number 10. I'm looking forward to you. Dennis and to Mackie. Did you have a last word in? Yeah.
Just isn't it interesting how so many of the issues we're talking about, I mean, I agree that I think people are too negative about South Africa. When I was there last year, it really felt like the Rainbow Nation was coming together there, finally, I thought, and it was incredible with the young people, the feeling of change. But isn't it interesting how it's the same issues you're facing there about concern about the disenfranchisement of people, concern with the political process, the political classes. Migration, we always see migration as a uniquely British and European problem, but of course it's Africa has got a far more movement of people in it. You know, it's interesting that some of the worst victims in South Africa are the Somalian shopkeepers, who are doing really good, small business people, and they're being burned out of shops sometimes. And it's a sign, again, that it's the same issues. Corruption, of course, a lot of it washes up in London, and we forget that. We talk about African corruption, but so much of it is washed here by our estate agents and lawyers and banks and such like. These are global issues that confront everyone at both local, national, and supranational level.
Thank you. Okay, we're going to move on. I would say that's gone, but I cannot. Dennis, it's been great to talk to you. So lovely to see you, Mackie. I will see you both tomorrow morning. Look forward to that. This is Peanuts Politics, much more coming up. The time is 10:37.
On digital, online, smartphone and tablet, this is BBC Five Live.
Five Live News, I'm Kate Williams. The Road Haulage Association has stepped up its demand for the French